when I've been writing about hope forever, since I wrote a book called Traveling Hopefully about getting over family baggage. A couple of you, I'm really honored that you've heard of it or read it. But that was about finding that spirit of hope, that just that flicker of however you think of that inspiration, that sort of internal flame, your own faith, whatever it is that moves you. And I discovered it wasn't just me thinking about hope, but there was in fact a body of science out of medicine and positive psychology. And one of the preeminent hope theorists is this fellow, a man named Dr. Jerome Groopman. And Dr. Groopman was a Harvard-trained cardiologist, oncologist. And Dr. Groopman, Harvard-trained oncologist, early researcher in AIDS, and he coined this term, this hope theory, and he says hope is comprised of two key components, belief and expectation. And here's what he means by that. In this book called The Anatomy of Hope, which has become really one of my guiding principles, that and Viktor Frankl's book, Man's Search for Meaning, if you're looking for anything, both highly readable, not meant for scientists, really for the layperson, but Dr. Groopman said, belief, it's first a belief that change is possible. Now we think about that and you think, of course, we all believe change is possible. But look around your world. Think about your own world. Who is it in your life, in your personal or your professional life, that says things like, well, you can't fight City Hall. It's just the way it is. It is what it is. Don't beat your head against the brick wall. Those are people who are there, stuck in the status quo. They're going to defend it with every ounce they've got. And Dr. Groopman said, belief that change is possible. That's, you start with that. Next is an expectation that what you do as an individual is what drives the outcome. It's not your boss, it's not your spouse, it's not the government, it is what you do, the actions you take. So it's really about belief driving behavior. Belief driving behavior. And what Dr. Groopman found as a young clinician giving diagnoses to patients and patient families about cancer, at first he thought, I've got to tell them everything. I've got to give them all the facts. And any of you who've had a long-term illness or a loved one, you've gone through that, you know there's this point of overwhelm. And he discovered that he was giving so much information that people just, they couldn't take it in. And in fact, it had the reverse effect. They stopped participating in their own healing process because it was just too much to handle. So he did what we often do in the work world when we're correct for mistakes. He sort of, the pendulum swung all the way to the other end of the spectrum, and he began to give people very limited information. I'm just going to tell them what they need to know. And the effect of that was that when people didn't hear a lot of information, they felt like, well, no news is good news, must be okay, even when in fact that was not the case. He put them into what he later called a state of false hope. And so he had to find that sweet spot right in the middle where he was giving people the real diagnosis, including all the negatives. But at the same time, he was leaving them that window of hope. So he gave them the reality of the situation without crushing their sense of hopefulness. And that is what he said was true hope. Then there's another fellow who came at it from a different direction, Dr. Rick Snyder. He was a professor at the University of Kansas, positive psychology. And he said to him, hope was about willpower and way power. Willpower being what you think of, that mental stamina, the fortitude, the grit, perseverance, you know, that gets you out of bed in the morning, quite frankly, gets you from point A to B to Z. But another thing that was so important that he said was it was also about way power. And what he meant by way power was there's not just one way to the end result. We're not living in the industrial age anymore when if you want to change, all you could do is speed up the line. We are in, some people call it an information age. I think of it more as an imagination age. We are in the age of ideas. And so what Dr. Snyder said, this sense of way power was the ability to find not one way or the way, but multiple pathways to the end result. And for those of you that are managing others, you know how critical it is to pass some of that down, to let people take positive risks. You're not going to bet the company on your brand new intern, as much as you may love them, but you're going to pass some of the ownership and the authorship down to people so that they find the end result. Here's the outcome we were looking for. Have at it. I'm going to check in, find a way to get there. And that's so critical to keep hope alive that you say, hey, this door just slammed in my face. I'm going to try this one.